Skeleton Key Orchestra is a large ensemble based out of San Diego, California, formed in 2001 by percussionist and composer Nathan Hubbard. Interest in a cross-platform ensemble fusing notation and improvisation together led Hubbard to bring together different ensembles he was involved with, from the quartet's Cosmologic and Return to One to the found percussion trio Nod, members of the Tremor Flora Collective, and many other players from the San Diego music scene. The resulting ensemble was somewhat akin to a jazz big band with a double rhythm section and additional strings and percussion. Hubbard began the group by composing two long-form pieces, Rain Castle and A Murder of Crows. Both pieces were designed to feature single soloists as well as group solos using a variety of notation devices. After the first two concerts in 2001, Hubbard revised these pieces, added several new pieces that would be documented on the Encinitas and Everything After project, and presented several concerts with a slightly smaller ensemble. He also began the Splinter Group project, presenting concerts of smaller ensembles breaking apart the group, a string ensemble called the Rubber Band, a brass group called the Looking West Ensemble, a woodwind ensemble, and the Skeleton Key Percussion Ensemble. There were also improvisation workshops presented semi-regularly. All this was a means to break down musical and social barriers and allow more performance opportunities. All this work led up to the 2003 recording of this music.
So when you talk about this era, of course, you have to look at a few years previous, and there was a lot of work. There was different groups happening. I was in two different quartets, both of them, two horns, bass, and drums. The first, Return to One, which was a quartet that I was leading and was pretty much playing exclusively my music. The second, Cosmologic, which was a collectively run band, and we were playing everybody's music. In addition to that, there was a found percussion trio called Nod that I was leading, where we each brought our percussion, junk percussion, found percussion in together and improvised. And I was involved with the Tremor Flora Collective, and there was multiple different ad hoc performances and playing with lots of different people from that. So my thought was, it seemed so simple at the time, just to put all these people together and write some really kick-ass music, and it would be great, right? And it seems kind of hilariously optimistic when you look back at it. The first two performances we did, the first was at a radio broadcast, and the second was at a college. So after that, we were kind of thrust into the real world, and we had to deal with things like, does this performance space have enough room, have a stage big enough for this group to fit on? Are there enough chairs there to put the group up? Things I never had to deal with. If you have a trio or a quartet, it's fairly easy to find a rehearsal space. When you have 18, 20, 22 people, it gets a little more tricky. So regardless of that, the music continued and the music grew, and that was really important. I was really interested, and I was writing a lot of what I referred to as link structure. So there'd be notation, and there'd be improvisation, and notation, improvisation. And I figured out ways to sort of transition between that using bass lines or different things like that. So you hear a lot of that in the early pieces that I wrote, Rain Castle, A Murder of Crows. I also, of course, in this situation, there's so many strong voices. You really wanted to feature all these different soloists, but you also wanted to feature all these groups. There's multiple groups that I didn't even mention. And so a lot of what we were doing was sort of a concerto grosso, where there would be a group that would improvise and there would be backgrounds against them. Cosmologic would play for a while and there'd be backgrounds, things like that. So dealing with this, when you get into a large ensemble, you're always thinking about the individual versus the ensemble and how that fits together and how you really make music with that.
Released in 2004 on the Circumvention Music label, the group's self-titled debut pushed Hubbard's concept of cross-platform music, having multiple focuses and interests. The resulting music moved from dense improvisations to floating melodies, odd-meter grooves to searing solos, receiving positive reviews both nationally and internationally, as well as placing on multiple Best of the Year lists. The group celebrated their release with a featured concert on the Spring Reverb Festival in San Diego, debuting seven new pieces from Vinny Golia, as well as featuring Golia as a soloist. It was also at this time that Hubbard made a major shift in his role, stepping out from behind his drum kit to conduct the ensemble. Inspired by all this work, Hubbard continued to write new music, debuted several of these pieces at the Ensenada Jazz Festival 2005 and began plotting for a second documentation of the group entitled Furiously Dreaming.
So originally the lineup was three trumpets, two tenor trombones, bass trombone, five, six woodwinds from flute, clarinet, saxophone, soprano sax, all the way down to Jay Easton's subcontrabass saxophone, two drummers, two bass players, two percussionists, guitar, and electronics. And then that shifted, you know, the third trumpet was so low in the register that I realized it would work better with the French horn, and then of course you realize how well the French horn mixes with the alto saxophones, and you want to give them melodies, and these things happen, slowly things shift, new people come into your life, you have a Nazo Zakok in your life, of course, you're going to use piano. One of the most interesting things, especially by the time we got to the first record, was that I was trying to do this impossible deal of being the drummer, being the band leader, being the composer, and my friend Christopher Adler was totally kicking ass being the conductor. And I realized that for it to work how I was seeing it, I had to stop being the drummer and I just had to be the conductor. So that was a major shift where I stopped playing drums and I was up front. First time that happened was with the release concert for the first record where we played with Vinnie Golia, and it's been that way since. So these shifts kind of happen, and you know, they definitely happened as we get closer to Furious Dreaming. Between the first and the second record, a lot of things happened. I wanted to expand on what I did in the first record. I wanted to write different structures, closed structures, more of everything that happened, electronics, grooves, open playing, improvisation, all of these different things. We just heard a little bit of a piece called Rain Castle, a melody. And that was kind of, you could hear that going back to Return to One, sort of a modal melody with backgrounds and things. When you look at that score, the score's got to be 30 pages long, right? Rain Castle's a huge piece. That's the first record. The second record, you get to a piece like The Owl of Brittany Road, which is, I think the score is only 3 pages, and that's the full score. So, finding ways to use material, staying in certain things rather than going everywhere with a piece. These were kind of my thoughts, and that was what was going on as we got closer to that. Thank you.
By 2006, the performing aspects of the large group scaled back considerably, with many of the key players in the ensemble moving out of state and shifts in the music scene making performing spaces able to fit larger group non-existent. Despite these changes, Hubbard pushed on, spending 2007 to 2010 recording Furiously Dreaming, a collection of 8 pieces designed to fit across 2 CDs. With plans for an extended production and only 2 days in the studio with a complete band, much of the 3 years were spent recording smaller group and soloists, with multiple recording sessions each month. Hubbard drew from recent smaller groups such as Arc Trio, Obscura Khan, Wormhole, and others, as well as pushing the possibilities of vocal ensembles, expanded production options, and new friends. As time passed and sessions continued, the era's shift to digital music led Hubbard to question the best way to present this music, but familial obligations and a move to Arizona had him putting the release on the back burner for a moment.
So by the time you get to 2005, 2006, you have the other 3 members of Return to One living in other states and that group not active at all. Cosmologic living a cross-country life, and me pushing on, starting different groups, playing with people that I hadn't played with before. So there was a lot of work in that regard in terms of trying out different things, really trying to push myself to try new forms, do different things. When we started the Furiously Dreaming, and actually previous to that, there was a lot of thought of, okay, well, I did this on this record, how can I push that farther? And then also new ideas. And I think any record you have, there's certain things you realize, okay, well, that's sort of a dead end, but this, I can definitely take that farther. So the link structure thing maybe wasn't as prevalent on the second record, but you see different ideas. For example, the tune And We All Fall Down is actually just a 16-bar closed form that repeats for the entire tune. There's a little release section, but that's pretty much all that happens. So that was really interesting. You saw the difference between Rain Castle and the Owl of Brittany Road. All these things sort of, push forward. I wanted more production, I wanted drum loops, I wanted electronics, I wanted vocal ensembles. That was a main thing for Furiously Dreaming. How could I bring in a vocal ensemble? There was a little bit of that on the first record. A Murder of Crows used some spoken word. There was, of course, Shannon Perkins on the first record. I wanted to feature more poets. So these were the thoughts. The first recording session was actually the first thing you hear on Furiously Dreaming, which is the group improv from Obscura Khan. And then, of course, we just sort of worked through this way. I had 2 days with the full band and then several years where I worked on things, doing different recordings, editing, tweaking, etc., etc., etc. This period also, of course, I got married, started a family. So you start to realize maybe your plans... My plans in my 20s was to put out a new large ensemble record every 2 to 3 years and get to the point where... that's maybe not feasible or not even possible. So I definitely took my time, got exactly what I wanted out of it. Also in this period, I moved to Arizona, which was one of the greatest things that happened in my life, actually, because I didn't know a single person out there, and I had to completely sort of recreate myself. Nothing that I had done previous to that, none of the touring, putting out records, nothing mattered at all. So it was really great for me to sort of... look back on what I had done and figured out what I wanted to do in the future. So a lot of that contributed to Furiously Dreaming.
Released in 2016 on Arenda Records, Furiously Dreaming showcases a broad outlook on the large ensemble tradition, pushing the cross-platform concept further by incorporating samples, electronics, field recordings, and post-production manipulation into the mix for a massive, wholly unique sound all its own. Hubbard's belief in orchestra as microcosm of society shines brightly here, where independent voices speak and groups shout. Critical reaction was positive, with Avant Music News calling it a brilliantly compelling album of dense, uncategorizable music, and All About Jazz remarking, it's an ever-shifting mobile of sound that simply doesn't let up. The release concert, centered around Hubbard's 40th birthday, featured a 22-piece ensemble with past members coming to town from Oregon, Arizona, and Baja, Mexico, as well as featuring many members new to the group. Hubbard used the opportunity to showcase 15 years of work, performing pieces dating from the ensemble's first performance to a brand new debut.
What happened as we got 2007, 2008, these things kind of went on. There was a major shift as well where people were trying to figure out how to present their music, talking about the CD is dead, people presenting things in a digital format. And it's interesting because this record was designed, Furiously Dreaming was designed to be exactly like the first record, in the sense that there were 8 compositions, 4 on each disc, and it was presented as a double CD. So there was a lot of thought and a lot of time spent trying to figure out the best way to present this music, because that's how it was designed, and I didn't want to present it in any other way. And of course, you know, you spend all this time on this music, and you spend years writing it and rewriting it and revising it, and you spend time rehearsing it and performing it, and you record it, and of course you want people to hear it. You can't just piss into a void. You have to have it be heard, otherwise it doesn't exist. There's plenty of music playing in my head constantly, but none of that actually exists because nobody else has heard it. So anyways, there was a lot of time spent trying to figure out how to present it, the best way to present it, and that was a challenge, I think. There was plenty of challenges in that period. You don't want to repeat yourself, you want to do new things. You want to find new forms, you want to push yourself, you want to do different things. I started a group called Passengers that was sort of my push towards playing music that was a little bit more based around harmony rather than melody, because pretty much previous to that, with a few exceptions, most of my music was pitch-based, melody-based. And that continues to this day, but I wanted a band that wasn't so focused on playing a melody, the improvisations based on melody. Somehow to meld the improvisation and the notation and different things like that. So a lot of that has affected what's happened since Furiously Dreaming. I've been writing pieces that are much more modular, much more pitch cell based. There's all sorts of different things, and that's good. I think things continue on. There's plenty of new music to make, and that will continue to happen. We'll be right back.
Originally started as a means to feature and expand different sections of the large ensemble, the splinter group project has evolved over the years into ensembles with distinct music and aesthetics. More recently, the splinter group project has shifted into smaller groups playing condensed version of the larger scores.
So the splinter group project was an interesting thing. It actually started really innocently. I wrote a piece for the first recording called Next Loved, All Things Want to Fly. And it was just for strings and percussion for two drummers. And from there I figured maybe I can just start a band with that, and it would give us a chance to play beyond the large ensemble. You know, you get into these, when you have that many people and you're in a rehearsal and you're trying to prepare for a performance, you're spending all this time there. And so maybe we just pull these people aside and we can play some gigs. That band actually had the strangest trajectory. It started out playing tunes, chord changes, melodies, things like that. And after a while, it progressed to the point where we were just doing completely improvised performances. The band shifted as well, where in the beginning it was two drummers, two bass players, two guitar players, cello, violin, and by the end of it, it was two percussionists mostly playing amplified instruments, and bass, cello, violin, several electric guitars. So that was interesting. The brass band was called Looking West Ensemble, and I wanted to sort of push the West African brass sort of tradition. So we played a few gigs and wrote a bunch of pieces for that. That was actually a really good learning experience, dealing with sort of the registers and things like that. The woodwind ensemble, I believe, only played one performance at the space, and I don't believe ever played again, which maybe says something. I don't know what that says. That just happened. The percussion ensemble is maybe the most prolific, playing multiple gigs, multiple performances, did a bunch of performances doing music for a live film. We also did some work with Rebecca Bryant, the great dancer, and just a bunch of different things, and I actually have a giant set of recordings that I'm going to put out at some point of that group. A bunch of really interesting things, really pushing the sort of percussion ensemble tradition in a few different areas. The splinter group idea, I didn't really realize until we got into this and we started talking about this, but the splinter group idea of having these smaller groups playing this music continues on today, because when I put out Furiously Dreaming, I realized, okay, we're going to do this 2016 performance, we're going to have all these people play on it, it's going to be great. And it was. But I can't do 20, 30 performances with that band. I would love to have multiple people hear this music, but that's never going to happen. So I started doing performances with smaller groups, a trio with Ed Kornhauser and Harley Maxino, piano trio, a trio with Ellen Weller and Jerome Salazar, woodwinds, bass, and percussion, quartet with Nate Jarrell and Grant Fisher, Harley and myself. So we're playing different sort of condensed versions of these pieces. We'll play maybe just the melody of Raincastle, or the guitar quartet was focused a lot on the bass lines. We play these different bass lines from these different tunes. So the splinter group sort of continues in a very different vein. We're still playing, and I'm still using those ideas to get this music out there. What's interesting is that this music continues to sort of expand beyond large ensemble. Splinter group, I've gone to Arizona and played this music with a student ensemble, gone to Ensenada and performed it with musicians down there. So the music continues to be played by people that aren't in the ensemble, which is kind of amazing because that's never happened, which I think is what needs to happen. I'm not quite sure. I'm not quite sure how this all continues. But, you know, clearly the music needs to be played, and that seems to be an honest way of getting it out there and having people hear it more.
We sing for us, we sing for all our dreams. We sing for us, we sing for all our dreams. We sing for tomorrow, we sing for today. Find strength with us through.
How we doing? My wife told me not to say too much, so I don't know if it's working. How's my hair? What's that? Oh, the name of the documentary? It's one of the first performances we did. There was a guy doing sound, and there was some students helping him. And one of the students asked him, "What do you call this music?" And he said, "It's atonal, bordering on unlistenable." Is to really just keep pushing and keep it. No, this is fucking up. I need to redo this again. This sucks.